Because my fingers are itchy as heck. Especially with these 20-day banners, I'm like... Alright. Downloading. Oh, dupe! I don't want to do this, but I'm gonna... Oh. At least it's a new 3, I think. Okay. Okay, come on, Kyoka. Come on. Just be Kyoka. Come on. It's a new one. It's a new one. Yes! 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 Oh! 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 152! Oh my god. Oh, that is me. I am an average citizen. 0.7% I pull Kyoka. That's what I do, man. Thank god it didn't make me go to 300. Holy crap. Hi. Welcome back to another Princess Connect video. My name is Lace and today I'm going to be talking about Arena. Well, in particular, I'll give you about 10 or so Arena tips. Why do we do 10? I don't know. It's a nice round number, but let's just get into it. This one, I suppose, is going to be the Kyoka edition because a lot of them are focused around Kyoka. There are a lot of interesting things about Kyoka that we can actually do that affects a lot in Arena. I don't know if I would call her meta changing, but she has definitely changed the... Okay, I guess that is kind of meta changing, isn't it? All right, let's get into our first tip, which is what you see on the screen. So biggest tip, if you have not watched any of my videos before, is to actually use PCRD fans. However, it's not to just use PCRD fans. What the tip really is about is that you can't follow any of these comps blindly. For example, for the longest time, I was actually using this comp here. I did not have the means to deal with this Reno cannon in any other way. And so what I had to resort to was something like this. This works so fantastically. But the moment I started seeing Reno 4s and Reno 5s, this comp stopped working. A lot of comps actually vary. So the comp that I featured in my Tamaki stall, which is like, it's the Nozomi, the Makoto, the Monika, the Akari, and the Mitsuki. Honestly, the star levels has not changed that one dramatically. But like for this one, like the moment that the Reno gets one more star, it's all over for me. I personally have new answers to this thanks to Kyoka. But like, yeah, I'm just trying to say here, especially when my Mitsuki is 5-star and I start losing to this, like it's kind of weird. And you can see why there are thumbs downs. It's just like, you just got to kind of make sure that your comp, like you either follow it exactly and have more stars or like risk it not working. All right, tip number 2. So hot new Kyoka tip. Let's freaking go. So Kyoka can actually avoid a lot of the meta AoE comps. So it's kind of like this one. This is the Premier Reno Cannon, whose idea is to kind of like lay down the AoE defense downfield and then drop a bomb on them. Because of Kyoka's insane range, really, this is more of a counter to Reno herself and Ninon herself as well, because Ninon runs a very similar bomb. What Kyoka can do actually is, if I flick over to this one right here, you guys should be able to see that. So you can see here, this is a pretty scuffed comp. Here we've got a 5-star Reno comp, which is absolutely massive. Normally, 5-star Reno comps will utterly obliterate the mages. Mages will take one ult from Reno and they will all die. However, as you can see here, we are equalizing the distance gain by Lima. So what happens is that we are not now being pulled towards their team. We are now being pulled towards the middle because there are two Limas. So what has happened is that the range has actually reset. So Kyoka is back to how far she would normally be from the center, like that. And Reno is also where she is supposed to be, like without the Lima. And what happens here is that when Reno bombs, she doesn't bomb Kyoka. What happened here is that Kyoka could actually fire off everything and utterly melt the team, to be honest. With the Monika by her side, she just demolished this team. And I guess the key lessons here is really mainly that Kyoka can avoid pretty much every AoE if she has at least a Lima. But this is not my screenshot. This is one of my friend's screenshots. And this is actually really smart because he ran this blind into team 3. I just wanted to showcase another one here. So we've got a 39k comp versus a 47k. Comp. I know the Kyoka is absolutely juiced, but I guess this was more of a meme comp since we've got like a freaking Miyako up here. What's happened here is that the Miyako is actually able to block everything and hold them at the front, right? So that they can't get any closer to the Kyoka. The Kyoka then just proceeds to smoke them. And I admit it, like this is probably a more whaley meme comp, but like I think the idea is that I just wanted to re-emphasize that, remember guys, comps over power. Tip number 3, and it's that Tamaki and Arisa are actually like a really great combo. As you guys can see
here I don't feature an Arisa, but I'm about to explain why. We've got a Tamaki, right? And Tamaki targets the highest magical attack unit. On the other hand, Arisa also cripples the highest magic attack unit. So if you think about it, if you're adding a Tamaki and an Arisa, and even maybe add a Monica to it, this is a great way to deal with mages on the enemy team. However, I had the bright idea of adding a Saren in because I wanted the Saren to actually TP boost the Tamaki. It didn't work because the Arisa was way too close to the Saren. So the Saren actually kept TP boosting the Arisa. And why I didn't want that is because usually you want to get rid of the high damage threat first. So more often than not, it's actually the Hatsune you're trying to get rid of. And then you're trying to like battery the Tamaki into killing the Hatsune first. If you battery into the Arisa, then the Arisa is just going to keep smashing the front line. So I know that this comp is not against like the Hatsune, for example, but this Tamaki went on to just like kill Hoshiori and then kill like the Ninon and so forth. But there are a couple of points that I'm trying to make here. Tamaki, Arisa, and Monica work well. Tamaki, Saren, and Arisa do not work. What actually does work is actually replacing the Arisa with a Shuri instead. Range does work then, and all is kind of well. The second main key point to take away from this is to know your Saren values. What I mean by that is your ranges. So this is actually the range like from the very front, right? So Lima is 105 units from the center. What we have then is Saren, that's about, I think, 430. I think that's Saren. And so what that means is that the person closest will actually get the juicer, right? So 430, 625, that's about 195 distance, I think. If we compare Saren back over to Tamaki, it's 215, which is unfortunate. That puts Arisa closer than Tamaki to Saren. What you can also do is actually come down to this chart, and what we have is Saren is zero here, Tamaki is 215 units away, and then you've got here Arisa is 195 units away, which means that my original plan did not work. So again, key takeaway, guys, I'll drop this in the link below, but when you're designing your teams, this is a big thing to think about. Tip number three is potentially don't go for the 8-5 Nozomi. Leave her at 8-4 with the amulet. And the reason is very, very simple, because it's similar to the CB kind of principles. If you're too tanky, which is usually the case for DPS, then you're not going to get your Yubi off in time. One of my key strategies against the Tamaki stall, and people are still using Tamaki stall, it's crazy. Wait, so am I. One of the key strategies is to use Nozomi paired with Monica to actually get Nozomi's Yubi off before Tamaki can get it off. What this does mean then is that the Tamaki actually attacks the Nozomi instead of going for the Kyoka, because Nozomi's Yubi taunts all of the enemies. However, ever since I added this bracelet on, which is given like a significant amount of defensive stats, that comp has started to become kind of unreliable, maybe like a 70 to 80% success rate. And a key reason is that Nozomi just became a little bit too tank. She now sometimes does not take enough damage for her to actually get her Yubi off in time before Tamaki's Yubi to successfully taunt her. However, I do feel like the pros outweigh the cons. Even taking that like 20, 30% risk, it's enough. And a big reason for that risk is that this bangle actually gives 20 magic attack. What this means is that if you're running a Nozomi into a team that has a Tamaki, but your team does not have any magic attackers, it means that the Tamaki will always target your Nozomi. Your physical backline is actually safe, providing that they don't have magic attack themselves. That kind of brings me to my next point, which is this bangle, right? If I come back over here, I've got Mitsuki with this bangle here. So one thing that I'm debating with myself is whether I want my Mitsuki, who is more of like a bruiser support type, to actually get targeted by the Tamaki. It's kind of good because usually Mitsuki can live through the first Tamaki Yubi, which means that she still has value because she can stay on the field. I guess the point I'm trying to make here, the tip, is that a slight change in equipment, even equipping this, even refining it, it changes the comp completely. You guys already saw it with the Nozomi. This actually gives me a guard against Tamakis if I'm running full physical comps. And adding the sacrificial bangle here actually gives me a lot of, I guess, how do I call it, stability into my comp, right? I know that if I put this on, the Tamaki will always target my Mitsuki. My next point is actually about this Mitsuki itself. So a 5-star Mitsuki, so many trade-offs. So I personally went with a 5-star Mitsuki because I did not have, and I still don't have, Ninon and Reno. I found that Tamaki stall comp and I was like, wow, Mitsuki does like pretty decent AoE damage. She's also one of the units that I really need to use in clan battle, so why not 5-star her first? However, if one day I did pull Ninon or I did pull Reno, I guess what we could refer to my Mitsuki is as bricked. Why is my Mitsuki bricked? It's because she has has way too much attack now, 3.2k attack. If I only had like a Reno or a Ninon 3 or 4 star, a big thing about Reno and Ninon is that you run them into Hatsune so that the Hatsune attacks the Reno or Ninon so that they can get the Yubi off faster. However, because Mitsuki's attack is so high, we've got Hatsune attacking my Mitsuki instead of the Reno or the Ninon. There's actually a couple of ways around this. The first is that maybe you just like don't equip items. This item doesn't matter, but for example, you could have not like equipped this one. Another way around it is that you actually leave your Mitsuki at a lower level. So when the 93 cap comes out, then I'll probably, if I have a Reno or a Ninon, I would leave my Mitsuki at a lower level. All you really need to do to unbreak it is make sure that the Reno or Ninon has a higher physical attack than the Mitsuki. Speaking of this physical attack stat, this kind of brings me to my next point, which is buffs. Always include buffs in your calculations. And this is another Kyoka thing. It's not about Kyoka, but it's one that's very important to Kyoka. So you see here, Kyoka has almost 3.1k magic attack. However, that's not her true magic attack all the time, right? If you look here, her skill 2 actually boosts her own magic attack by another 2.5k. Now, why is this important? It comes back to Tamaki. Tamaki is probably one of the main counters to Kyoka right now. You could feel a bit sneaky and be like, okay, well, using my last logic from before, like the whole Reno versus Mitsuki thing, I should just find another mage that has like a more magic attack than this. However, that doesn't really work because if you remember, Kyoka's ability, the skill 2, actually gives her 2.5k extra magic attack. And it's at that moment that if the Tamaki UBs and the Kyoka has that buff up, then Kyoka is probably going to get attacked even if like your Anna, for example, has 3.1k attack. This, I suppose, is just an extra step to the calculation and will definitely like affect your team comp. Therefore, you could try catching the Tamaki with like a Kuka or something. But yeah, definitely something to think about. So if you've been running the Mage Melt comp, Kyoka actually does change things a little bit. I personally like playing front to back, and Mage Melt kind of is that idea. The idea of Mage Melt is that you actually have three mages, so you can see here, to melt things from front to back. What you also have is a Monica to make it all go faster, and you've got a tank to act as the wall. Obviously, the one tank that you have better be like really good to actually tank it all. I think Nozomi is a great fit. A 5-star Jun could be a great fit. A 5-star Pekarin could be a great fit. But usually, everyone has a 5-star Nozomi or will eventually get it because of the dungeon coins. What's changed, in my opinion, is that Kyoka will take up Hatsune's spot. And why that's really important is that because you see Akari and Anna, they actually attack front to back. They don't have any targeting moves like Hatsune does. Kyoka also does that. So what that means is that you actually have three mages focusing on the front line then. If all three mages are focusing on the same unit, it means that those units will melt. And so they melt one by one. The idea is to try to melt through them before they can even UB. So in my opinion, Kyoka is a great addition to that. However, if you're dealing with like a Tamaki or like a high priority, like physical attacker unit, I guess, then Hatsune could definitely be something you pull in as well. One of the irreplaceable ones, in my opinion, right now is Akari. Akari just has the magic defense down on her Impish Kiss, and it just does too much. I've got one more tip for you guys, and it's about Kyoka, and it's about Miyako and Kuka comps. For example, I know this is a weak looking comp, but like the idea again of Mage Melt is that you're attacking from front to back, right? What this means is that you're trying to break through the tank as fast as possible. However, what happens when there are two tanks? So there are a couple of scenarios that actually work. So you see, you got Miyako here and you've got a Kuka here. What's great about this setup is that the Kuka can actually taunt and actually take some of the aggro away from the Miyako so that they both kind of live. Obviously, if your Kuka is not strong enough, then she will eventually die, leaving your Miyako alone. However, what's interesting is that when you run a Kyoka into this, even when the Kuka taunts, the Kyoka will keep attacking the Miyako. And that's really, really good because the Miyako is what's stopping all of your physical DPS. You definitely don't have to take Kyoka with your Mage Melt comp. You can use her as a standalone just to deal with even this, like both of these together. So just to come back to explain why Kyoka does not attack the Kuka, even though Kuka is taunting. I think, and I'm not 100% sure, but I think it's because Kyoka is actually like X amount of units. Let's say like 1,000 units away from Miyako. Kuka's taunt is global, so she forces everyone to try attack her. But if you've got a Kyoka who's like way out of range, then Kyoka can't physically attack the Kuka. What I mean by that is that if Kyoka's attack range is like say 1,000 and the Kuka is like 1,100 away, but at range 1,000, you've got the Miyako that's blocking your Kyoka. And what that means is that the Kyoka is not allowed to walk forward. So what this means is that the taunt actually does not affect the Kyoka. Guys, I'm not 100% about that theory there, but what I do know is that if you run Kyoka into this, Kyoka will destroy that Miyako first before destroying the Kuka, I guess. So I guess the practical use for this is that remember that Kyoka is an answer to this. However, if there is a Tamaki on this team as well, then you got to think a little bit more. All right, guys, I can't remember how many tips that was. I'm just going to say it's 10 tips, right? Because 10 is a nice number. And let's call it a wrap because I'm kind of getting annoyed of my own voice. All right, guys, secret question. How about a secret question? Because I'm curious, did you guys pull for Kyoka and how many pulls did it cost gesture. For me, it costed me quite a lot, but you know what? I take average luck. Drop your response down below. I'll be keen to read it. And if you do answer the question, it means that you made it to the end of the video, in which I am forever grateful. All right, guys, there's nothing left to be said except that if this video has helped you, I guess leave a like, subscribe, follow. Otherwise, thank you guys so much for watching, and I will see you guys in the next video. Bye-bye.